for his life, to leave him in the keeping of God, his Creator, Redeemer, and Judge, to commit his body to be buried, and to comfort one another in our grief, in the hope that is ours through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Therefore we pray that here today we may know the peace of Christ in communion with all God's faithful servants. We sit for the hymn, Abide With Me.
Thank you.
children in our loss. Give to our troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen in us the gift of faith in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Seán and Kevin will now bring our readings to us.
This first reading will be done by myself on behalf of my mum. It's called Funeral Blues by W.H. Stop all the clocks, cut off the telephone. Friend's dog barking with a juicy bone. Silence and pianos on a muffled drum bring out the coffin that the mourners come. An airplane circle moaning overhead, scribbling on the sky the message he is dead. Put crossbows round the white necks of the public doves. Let the traffic policemen wear black cotton gloves. He was my north, my south, my east and west, my working week and my Sunday rest. My noon, my midnight, my talk, my song. I thought that love would last forever. I was wrong. The stars are not wanted now, put out everyone. Pack up the moon and dismantle the sun. Pour away the ocean and sweep up the wood. For nothing now can ever come to any good.
This is a short passage by James Joyce that Martin and I talked about not too long ago. Ding dong, the castle bell, farewell my mother. Bury me in the old churchyard beside my oldest brother. My coffin shall be black, six angels at my back. Two to sing and two to pray, and two to carry my soul away. How beautiful and sad that was, how beautiful the words were where they said, bury me in the old churchyard. A tremor passed over his body, how sad, how beautiful. He wanted to cry quietly, but not for himself. For the words, so beautiful and sad, like music, the bell, farewell, oh farewell.
A reading from the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you.
I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take
you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. Martin arrived with his wife in Ireland in 1984, and I met him shortly afterwards at a Sunday morning jazz session in Dublin. This 30-year-old unemployed academic with a doctorate in medieval history had left his native Basel in Switzerland to try his hand as a freelance correspondent. Back then, Ireland was barely covered in the German-speaking media, and it is tempting to think that his plan was destined to succeed, given what we now know. But those early years were difficult professionally. Of the 30 newspapers contacted, only 5 showed any interest in his freelance reporting from Ireland, including the Tagesspiegel in Berlin, the Presse in Vienna, and the Stuttgarter Zeitung. Broadsheets from Switzerland showed no interest, not even the NZZ. That came much later. During those early years, the young couple took on work as a tour guide for German-speaking tourists and translating from English to German in the days before Google Translate. Slowly but steadily, Martin's articles began to be accepted. Then, in 1985, Martin's coverage of a horrific attack with multiple fatalities in Northern Ireland propelled him into radio broadcasting, and he was soon a frequent contributor to German-speaking radio stations. From 2000 onwards, he covered the UK in addition to Ireland for many media organisations. In 2020, he was awarded the prestigious Max Geilinger Stiftung Prize in recognition of his contribution to the cultural relations between Switzerland and the English-speaking world. Within a year of their arrival in Ireland, the young Swiss couple had moved into Rosemount in Julianstown, County Meath, and started the process of renovation and transformation which created the wonderful house and garden that we see today. In this, they were partnered by their builder, John McAllister, and his wife, Maeve, and the gardener, Tommy. Into Rosemount, they brought donkeys and a long succession of Newfoundland dogs. They were active supporters of the Dublin Early Music Festival in this period. After his marriage ended, Martin met Dorothy in 2013, and they both grabbed a second chance at happiness together. He became a stepfather to Dorothy's 2 sons, Kevin and Seán, and a much-loved member of the extended Kenny family. Martin and Dorothy launched Ken Do Music together to promote local musical artists at home and abroad. And this led to a series of concerts by artists such as the Contempo Quartet, Forna Barr, who are singing beautifully for us today, and Dijis Kalnich, a classical pianist. Concerts were staged in the local community, in venues around Ireland and in Switzerland. Martin's role in this undertaking did not stop at organising and promoting events, but included comparing live concerts, narrating a performance of The Snowman, and singing in Dorothy's choir. The development of Rosemount Garden accelerated with the arrival of Dorothy and with the stalwart support of Billy in the garden and Gina in the house. During this time, the garden was thrown open to the community choir run by Dorothy, to yoga classes, and the house was the venue for Martin's Fireside Chats, a series of informal lectures on a wide range of topics of historical and current interest, ranging from medieval history to Brexit. Martin was passionate about many things. His love of trees and his encyclopedic knowledge of them made a walk in the Rosemount Garden with him an absolute joy. His love of dancing and Leonard Cohen songs made him great fun at a party, particularly the regular Rosemount Garden parties with Paddy Cole's band. His intellectual curiosity, wide reading, and articulate contributions made him a highly valued member of a book club that I was privileged to share with him. Martin's English-speaking voice was a joy to listen to, and while it always retained an erudite tone over the years, it was slowly penetrated by Irish expressions. He could refer to an unsavoury character as a bowsie. Not many Swiss foreign correspondents know that word, but Martin did. In short, Martin was many different things to different people. Husband, stepfather, uncle and granduncle, much loved family member, neighbour, historian, journalist and broadcaster, musical impresario, concert master of ceremonies and narrator, great, great cook and wonderful dinner host, but most of all, a friend to so, so many people. Rest in peace, Martin, my friend.
Liebe Dorothy, liebe Verwandte von Martin, liebe Freunde, liebe Trauergemeinde. Seine Stimme war brüchig geworden, manchmal musste er nach Worten suchen, manchmal wurde es sehr still, als ahnte er, dass künftig sowieso vieles ungesagt bleiben würde. Doch auch bei unserem letzten Telefonat drang manchmal noch sein uns allen bekannter Optimismus durch, dass das Glas halb voll nicht halb leer sei, dass es schon noch gut komme. Ob er selbst noch daran geglaubt hat, wissen wir nicht. Sicher jedoch wollte er, dass wir es glauben. Groß gewachsen, mit aufrechtem Gang und selbstbewusst, so habe ich ihn Mitte der 70er Jahre erstmals gesehen, als wir beide Geschichte studierten. Während die meisten von uns an der Universität eher leger angezogen waren, war er immer gut gekleidet. Weston, Flanellhose, oft im Anzug, gar mit Krawatte, eine auffällige Erscheinung. Wir interpretierten das als hochmütig, vielleicht wollte er sich aber damit auch nur schützen vor dem Lärm dieser Welt. Oder es war seiner Herkunft geschuldet. Martin stammte aus dem Basler Teig, dem protestantischen Großbürgertum, das Basel, seine Heimatstadt, geprägt und noch immer beeinflusst hat. Doch Martin passte, je älter er wurde, nicht mehr in diese Schublade. Das entdeckte ich, als wir uns näher kennenlernten, als er zusammen mit meiner Frau und vielen anderen selbstverständlich an der Ausstellung und dem Buch der neuen Stadtgeschichte Basels wirkte. Er, der Lord, wie einige ihn etwas despektierlich nannten, und ich, aus kleinbäuerlich-proletarischem Milieu der katholischen Innerschweiz stammend, verstanden uns auf Anhieb. Seine Neugier, sein Wissen, sein für mich damals erstaunlich kritischer Geist imponierten und daraus wurde eine Freundschaft. Der Abzug aus Basel und die Übersiedlung nach Irland mit seiner damaligen Frau Gabi änderten daran nichts und er befreite sich damit auch wohl etwas vom Korsett seiner Herkunft. Und seine Leidenschaft für Geschichte fand in diesem zu jener Zeit für Mitteleuropäer beinahe unbekannten Land Stoff. In Hülle und Fülle, nicht nur im Mittelalter, sondern auch in der Alltagswelt dieses einst britisch brutal kolonisierten Landes. Wir haben uns oft über dieses koloniale Erbe unterhalten und er als Historiker hat in seiner Berichterstattung dies immer mitgedacht. Das war für sein Publikum beim Schweizer Radio oder bei der Neuen Zürcher Zeitung äußerst wertvoll. Martin wurde zum Interpreten der irischen Zeitläufe, später auch der großbritischen und publizistisch aus der deutschsprachigen Welt war er nicht mehr wegzudenken. Wir haben ihm viel zu verdanken. Ich hatte das Glück, in all diesen Jahrzehnten mit ihm auch beruflich zusammenarbeiten zu dürfen. Wir haben die künftigen Schwerpunkte zu Faden geschlagen und über seine Berichte diskutiert. Bei mehreren Wahlen im Vereinigten Königreich, beim Schottland-Referendum oder bei der Brexit-Abstimmung gingen wir zusammen auf Reportage, manchmal allein, gemeinsam wieder, schlossen uns kurz, planten, stellten um, verwarfen und diskutierten, vor allem über die Form, über die Inhalte waren wir uns meist einig. Es war ein sehr fruchtbares und angenehmes Schaffen. Wenn es Differenzen gab, diskutierten wir das aus bei meist zu viel Wein und Rauch und zu wenig Schlaf. Und gesungen, das sei hier verraten, haben wir auch. In Hartlepool wurden wir einst aus einem Pub geschmissen. Er fand es eine Frechheit. Ich ein Glück, dass es wenigstens noch ein paar Stunden Schlaf gab. Das schien für ihn übrigens nie ein Problem gewesen zu sein. Am Morgen beim Frühstück war er wieder fit und setzte die Debatte des Abends fort, während ich mich noch sortieren musste. Martin lud mich oft nach Rosemount ein oder ich lud mich ein, weil es wieder Zeit war, dass wir uns sahen. Stolz zeigte er mir jeweils die Fortschritte beim Ausbau der verschiedenen Gebäude auf dem Gelände, das über die Jahrzehnte zu einem stattlichen Anwesen wurde. Nichts musste sofort passieren. Er und seine Helfer und Helferinnen nahmen sich die Zeit. Er hatte sich weit entfernt von der angelernten Hektik der Schweiz. Und er erklärte einem geduldig die Veränderungen im Garten, der mehr oder weniger zu einem repräsentativen Park wurde. Beeindruckend, wie er als Historiker die ganze Flora kannte, deren symbiotische Nachbarschaft und das Ganze noch in Latein. Das Haus, das ich zu Beginn meiner Besuche zur unbewohnten Ruine erklärt hatte, wurde während all dieser Jahre dank seinem Optimismus, seinem Zupacken und der Hilfe von Freunden zu einem kleinen Paradieshof. Und ich durfte verfolgen, wie er heimisch in Irland wurde, wie er Freunde gewann, wie Gary, John oder Meath. Meist unternahmen wir noch eine kleine Reise in die Wicklow Mountains, Connemara oder Antrim. Immer wusste er um eine interessante Kirche, um einen historisch wichtigen Platz oder wer hier oder dort das Sagen hatte. Und als dann nach seiner Trennung Dorothy auftauchte, war er unglaublich glücklich. So glücklich, dass er, der einst so protestantische Basler, das auch sagen konnte. Und mit Dorothy bekam er noch eine Familie. Er verriet, wie er sich um die Zukunft von Kevin und Seán Sorge machte, war stolz, wenn sie wieder einen Schritt vorwärts kamen. Und mit Dorothy zog auch wieder mehr Leben ins Haus. Aus dem ehemaligen Shed erklangen Geigen, zusammen organisierten sie Musikabende und er selbst sang im dörflichen Weihnachtschor mit. Ich war bei einer Probe selbst dabei, ich hätte es nie für möglich gehalten. Und dann der Krebsbefund, die Zeit des Bangen und Hoffens, die Chemotherapie und die Spitalaufenthalte, die Schmerzen und die Erschöpfung. Ich erlaubte mir bei unserem letzten Treffen, als wir einen kurzen Spaziergang am Meer machten, ihn zu fragen, ob er Panikattacken hätte. Er schaute mich ungläubig an. Nein, noch habe er Hoffnung und dieser sterbe bekanntlich zuletzt. Er meinte dies in seinem unerschütterlichen Optimismus. Noch sei das Glas halb voll. Jetzt ist es leer und wir müssen diese Leere, die sein Tod uns hinterlässt, erst einmal annehmen. Vor allem seine Familie, mein Beileid, liebe Dorothy, dir Kevin und Seán und all euren und seinen Nächsten und Lieben wünsche ich die Kraft, die er immer hatte, das Unabänderliche auszuhalten.
Thank you.
Would you please stand? We join in confessing the Christian faith, saying together, I believe. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We sit or kneel to pray, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your servant Martin and for the example that he has left to us. We thank you for the fellowship we have enjoyed with him and remember before you all that he achieved and all that he meant to each one present here and those who are following this service online. Although we mourn his passing this day, we rejoice in your promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whom the bond of peace is never broken. And a prayer for those who are bereaved. Give faith and comfort, O Lord, to all who are bereaved. Among them, Dorothy, Seán and Kevin. Strengthen them to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your mercy in the past and waiting for a joyful reunion in heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant us, Lord, the wisdom and the grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on this earth. Lead us to repent of our sins, those things left undone which we ought to have done, and those things which we have done that we ought not to have done. Strengthen us to follow in the steps of your Son, in the way that leads to the fullness of eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we join together in praying the prayer which Jesus Christ taught us, saying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Yeah.
Our help is in the name of the Lord, who has made heaven and earth. We keep a moment of silence. God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power, Christ conquered death and entered into glory. Confident of his victory and claiming his promises, we leave your servant Martin in your gracious keeping. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Dorothy has asked that I would take a moment as we approach the conclusion of this service to express the family's thanks to all who have had the care of Martin in more recent times. The staff at the Mater Private Hospital in Dublin and the team from the Palliative Care Unit in County Meath. Particular thanks are expressed to all those who have joined with us for this service of thanksgiving, either online or here in St Andrews in person. And I do know that some of you went to great lengths to be with us in Malahide this morning, and this is very much appreciated and an indication of the esteem in which Martin was held. Finally, music has been such an important part of this service, and rightly so. And it would be very remiss of me if I did not express my thanks and yours to Owen Conway and his colleagues in Four in a Bar. A Church of Ireland funeral service concludes traditionally with the words of the Nunc Dimittis, the Song of Solomon, words found in Luke's Gospel. Now, Lord, you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations, and the glory of your people, Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.